Naturally, to today's speaker, Dr. Fabiola Gianotti. Fabiola received her PhD from the University of Milano in 1989. And around the same time, she also received her professional music diploma as a professional pianist in the Milan Conservatory. And she was telling me before that for the last couple of years, she hasn't been able to keep up with her piano training, but she's going to come back to it. She worked in several CERN experiments, UA2, and then Aleph, and most recently in Atlas. She has been a member, a permanent member at CERN since 1994, and she has been the spokesperson, which means the head of the Atlas collaboration from March of 2009 until about a month ago. It's my honor to turn the floor to Dr. Gianotti.
Thank you. Thank you, Savas, for this very nice introduction. I'm, of course, very pleased and honored to be here and have the chance to give this prestigious memorial lecture in honor of Bob Hofstadter, because indeed he is one of the fathers of accelerator-based particle physics at the energy frontier. And I think he will be extremely happy and proud to see today the accomplishments of the most powerful accelerator ever built by mankind. This is the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. And in particular also to be able to see the most important accomplishments so far of this collider. And this is the discovery of the Higgs boson. So I will discuss, of course, the main theme and the main topic of this lecture will be the Higgs boson itself. But I would like to make some step back and start and to tell you a few words about CERN. So what is CERN? CERN is the European Laboratory for Particle Physics. is the world's most the biggest laboratory for particle physics in the world. It is based in Geneva, in Switzerland, and is a very special place. It's a place where over the past 50 years, scientists from all over the world have been doing fundamental research awarded by discoveries, many discoveries and Nobel Prizes. It's a place where the scientific goals require the development of technologies, cutting-edge technologies in several fields, innovation. One very famous example is the World Wide Web, which was introduced at CERN by this guy, Tim Berners-Lee, who was a staff member at CERN, and it was introduced to facilitate the exchanges among the physicists working at CERN, in experiments at CERN, and then, of course, we know very well, it has changed the way society accesses information. It's also a place where we train tomorrow's scientists, young physicists, but also school students and teachers. And it is also a very nice place to bring nations together by attracting scientists from all over the world. And actually, there are more than 10,000 scientists working at CERN coming from more than 60 different countries. So CERN was founded in the early 50s with the twofold goal of giving back prestige to European research after World War II by creating a center of excellence, and at the same time start mitigating the tensions, the first symptoms of the Cold War. Today, CERN has become a global laboratory, an international laboratory. It has 20 member states. All of them are for Europe, but also non-member states from all over the world and states who have an intermediate status, like the United States. These are called observer states. The yearly budget is about $1 billion US dollar. The contribution to this budget is shared among the member states in a way which is proportional to their income. So this corresponds to one cappuccino per European citizen. Now, it depends because it's an average, because in Italy the cappuccino is very cheap and very good. And then you move north and it becomes very expensive and poor quality. So it's not really the same thing for everyone. Okay. So this money is used to pay the salary of the personnel, of the staff, but it's used mostly to develop, maintain, operate the infrastructure, so the accelerators and the various installations, which are used by the worldwide community to do experiments at CERN. So this worldwide community, as I mentioned before, consists of more than 10,000 physicists from member states in blue, non-member states in red, and observer states observers are in green. Yes, and you can see that the largest contingent of scientists working at CERN comes from the U.S. 1,700 people, 1,700 scientists, physicists, and engineers as well. Working at CERN, and so of course the U.S. is giving a lot to CERN, but is also benefiting a lot from participating in these activities. Okay, so the primary mission of CERN is science, of course. So what we do, we study the elementary particles, among which we also find the building blocks of matters, electrons, and quarks, and the forces that control their interaction at the most fundamental level. So we all know today that matter is made of atoms, and we know that atoms are made of a nucleus and a cloud of electrons, and we know that nuclei are made of protons and neutrons, and we know that protons and neutrons are not elementary particles, but they are made of other particles, which, as far as we know today, are elementary, and these particles are called quarks. So as far as we know today, quarks and electrons are elementary particles. That is, they cannot be split into more elementary constituents. And actually, it was the work led by Bob Hofstadter here at Stanford, using the high energy physics laboratory in the late 50s, to demonstrate for the first time that protons and neutrons are not elementary particles, but have some substructures. And he did so by bombarding a target of hydrogen and deuterium using high energy electron beams, high energy for that time. Of course, now they are considered to be very low energy, but at the time they were high energy electrons. So that's why he's one of the fathers of high energy accelerators. And for this reason, as Professor Dimopoulos mentioned, he got the Nobel Prize in 1961. And it also affected the life of many students, generational students from all over the world. So this is one of the books that I've been using when I was an undergrad student in Milano. It's called Introduction to Energy Physics. It's a very famous book by Don Perkins, a British physicist. And you can see that there is, of course, several pages devoted to electron scattering, etc., nuclei. And there is this is the part relevant to Hofstadter's work, at least an excerpt of it. And it says the first experiment demonstrating the deviation of the scattering from that expected for a point particle, and thus measuring the form factors, were carried by Hofstadter and his collaborator in 1961 at CERN, and have since then been extended in numerous laboratories. So you see that I've underlined these lines, meaning that they were very important and they had to stay in my mind. So I was very much impressed by this work. But then, 10 years later, still here in this area at SLAC, in the SLAC laboratory, a team led by Richard Taylor demonstrated that protons and neutrons are made of smaller entities, which are named quarks, and gluons who keep them together inside the protons. And for this reason, this team got a Nobel Prize in 1990, so Richard Taylor shared a Nobel Prize with Friedman and Kendall. So it's quite amazing to see how Stanford has been central to understanding how the constituents of matter, how matter is made. So back now to particle physics and CERN. So particle physics at modern accelerators allow us to probe, to study fundamental laws of nature on this scale, at the scale of quarks, means at the level of 1/1 billionth of a meter. So accelerators can be considered at all effects microscopes, who allow us to probe matter at these scales. But these studies allow us also to understand, to give input, to get some knowledge, some understanding of the structure and the evolution of the universe. So the very small, the study of the very small, allow us also to understand the very big. And the reason is that we know today that the universe started 14 billion years ago with a big bang, a big explosion. It was very hot at that time, and then it expanded and cooled down, and with the cooling down, then structures started to form. First the atoms, then the nuclei, then atoms, and then the macrostructure that we know today, galaxies, stars, etc. But at the beginning of its life, the universe was extremely hot, and it can be considered as a gas of free elementary particles. So by studying elementary particles and their interactions, we can try to understand what happens. We can try to reproduce in the laboratory, under controlled conditions, the phenomena, the interactions, and the features that have characterized the early universe. So this is very nice, but what do we do in practice? How do we do these studies in practice? So I'm going to give you a simplified picture. It's not rigorous at all from the scientific point of view, so it should stay in this room. Well, there are three cameras, but okay, fine. Otherwise, I will be fired. So what we do is the following thing. We accelerate two beams of particles, for instance, two beams of protons, make them collide at very high energy. So they collide, and when they collide, what happens is that, well, let's say, again, in a simplified way, imagine the protons goes into 1,000 pieces, like when you collide two Ferraris at very high speed. And they go in thousands pieces, and so you can understand how the constituents of protons, the quarks, the gluons, interact, okay, at the most fundamental level. So this is the first thing. The second thing is that the energy produced in the interaction can transform itself into new particles. You know, a guy called Einstein said that energy equal mc squared, so energy can be transformed into matter and vice versa. And so you produce a lot of energy, and this energy can become new particles. And so particles that are too heavy to be observed at previous past accelerators can produce at modern accelerator which have enough energy to produce them. So the higher the energy, the more massive the particles produced can be. The other thing is that the energy that we produce in the interactions correspond to the temperature that the universe had in the very initial moments of its life. And so by studying, again, as I was saying before, we can reproduce in a controlled way the evolution, the history of the universe. The new particles, typically what they do, they disintegrate immediately, they decay immediately into known particles. And so what we do is we surround the collision region with instruments called detectors, particle detectors, which allow us to detect most, if not all, the products of the collision, to measure them in details, and so to understand what happened in the collision event, and so understand if a new particle was found, if a new phenomenon was at play, etc. So essentially, we need three things. We need accelerators, we need detectors, and we need computers. And of course, we need brains, so human beings running these things. And so accelerators, usually they are underground tunnels, usually rings, which are made of two elements. Electric fields, which are used to accelerate the particles, the protons, for instance, incrementally at each turn. And magnets, powerful magnets, which are used to confine, to guide the beams and keep them inside the ring and make them collide. So this is, for instance, a nice picture showing the LHC tunnels. So what you see here, these blue tubes are superconducting magnets. I will come back to this later on. Detectors, these are instruments, high-tech instruments, which are used to surround, covering the full solid angle, the collision point, and which have the purpose of detecting ideally all the particles that are produced in the interaction. We will see there are 1,000 coming out of each interaction, and measure their trajectory, measure their energy, identify that particle is an electron, is a photon, is another particle, and so give us a full picture, a full image of the collision event. And then, of course, computers to store, distribute, and analyze the huge amount of data that these detectors are recording. So the most powerful accelerator and the most, say, complex high-tech detector, the most advanced computing infrastructure have been developed in the context of the Large Hadron Collider, which is one of the most ambitious projects in science in general. Of course, these are the most, advanced technologies in the field of particle physics, but in general, this is a very impressive project on a larger scale. It has required the development of most innovative concepts and technologies in various fields, from cryogenics, new material, electronics, data transfers and storage, etc., and has required the effort of the international scientific community for more than 20 years. First discussion about Hadron Collider at CERN took place in the mid-80s, and first collision operation started actually in November 2009. So what is the LHC? The LHC is a 27-kilometer ring located 100 meters below ground at the border between France and Switzerland. So this is an aerial view of the region. This is Geneva Airport. This is CERN laboratory main site. Lake Geneva is down here. This is the these are the mountains, the Jura Mountains. This little white points indicate the border between France here and Switzerland here. I live here, but you don't care. Okay, fine. this circle indicates the location of the LHC ring, which is not visible on the surface. It's underground. Okay, so starting in November 2009, we have started to circulate two beams in the two opposite direction, two proton beams, and they have been colliding for the last 3 years, three, 4 years, at four points where we had built four big underground caverns and installed four big particle detectors to study the products of these collisions. So these detectors are called ATLAS and CMS. These are the two biggest detectors which have announced, which have reported the discovery of the Higgs boson, and two smaller detectors, ALICE and LHCb, with more specific physics goals that I don't have the time to discuss. So here I will concentrate mainly on ATLAS in particular. So I will concentrate on ATLAS in particular, although also CMS, of course, has reported the same discovery, because a team from Stanford, from SLAC, actually, is has made and is working very heavily in ATLAS, has made very important contribution to this experiment. So I will concentrate on that. Now, in general, US laboratories and universities have contributed a lot in a very crucial way to the construction of the accelerator, to the construction of the detectors, to the operation of these instruments, the accelerator and detectors, to the analysis of the data, and also, therefore, to the discovery of the Higgs boson. So I said that we need three things. We need accelerator, we need detectors, and we need computers. So I will go through now these three elements to show you why it was so challenging and so difficult. So the LHC has allowed us to reach unprecedented energy. The energy in the collision energy is 8 TeV. I will tell you what it means in a few seconds. And in a couple of years from now, we will go up higher up to 14 TeV. And this is 7 times larger than the energy of the previous most powerful collider, and this was the Tauron collider at Fermilab. So this is actually a huge amount of energy. It corresponds to 10 to the 14 times the temperature in this room, so 100,000 billion times the temperature in this room. However, it's a huge amount of energy concentrated on a small and a very small microscopic level. Because at a macroscopic level, it's actually very little energy, just one microjoule, which is just enough to swat a mosquito. So it's a huge amount of energy concentrated on a microscopic volume. Okay, so it's not dangerous macroscopically, as you can see. Now, the single most challenging component that has allowed us to reach, actually, this energy, so the single most crucial component which has allowed us to reach these unprecedented energies, is a set of 1,200 high-technology superconducting magnets. So the reason is that accelerating protons is not difficult, it's very easy. What is difficult in a proton-proton collider is to guide the protons and to keep them inside a ring, which is big, 27 kilometers, but it's not an enormous ring. It's like when you are on a racetrack with a Ferrari. And of course, if you are really running at very high speed, keeping the car in a circuit is not that easy. Okay? So the limitation to the energy comes from the magnetic field that you can produce to keep the proton inside the ring. And so we had to develop these high-tech magnets able to produce a very high field, 8.3 Tesla. Today there are magnets producing even higher field, but on single prototype, on single magnets. Here we have to build 1,200 to, of course, equip the full 27 kilometer ring, or at least most of it. So these magnets have to be superconducting because there is no way you can reach very high current and so very high magnetic field with normal magnets. If they are superconducting, they have to work at cryogenic temperature. So these magnets are made of 7,600 kilometers of niobium titanium, which is a very interesting superconducting material, and work at 2 Kelvin from absolute zero. This means minus 271. Degrees. So this makes the LHC actually the coldest place of the universe, because the outer space is at 3 Kelvin, whereas the LHC is at 1.9 Kelvin. So if you want to go to the coolest place in the world, this is where, in the universe, this is the place you should go. Okay. Sorry, I need some water. Detectors are also extremely challenging, very complex, and the detectors that we have built for the LHC are much more performing and require also a big jump in concept and technologies compared to their predecessor. So this is Atlas as an example. So it's a sketch of Atlas. Look at the size. It is 45 meters long, 25 meters high. So this is a five-story building. So to give an idea, this is a human being. Okay. Why so big? Because we need to absorb particles of very high energy produced in the collision, in the interaction. So therefore, you need big volumes to absorb them and to measure them. So this is the reason of the size. At the same time, this detector has to be very precise and very, in order to be able to track the individual particles produced in the collision. The collision will produce 1,000 particles, so they have to be able to measure their trajectory with very high precision, precision of a few microns, and a micron is a 1 millionth of a meter. And so they are made of 100 million individual sensitive elements that allow us to track every particle in all details and may be able to reconstruct it with very high precision. So for instance, this is a collision event recorded by the other experiment, the competitor, CMS. Only a few of the particles produced in a collision are shown. So the two beams interact, and you see that from the collision, many particles are produced, which release heats, these yellow points or this red energy, And then we, by fitting together these hits, we are able to reconstruct the trajectory of the various particles. So these detectors can be considered as giant digital camera. However, they have to be extremely fast because the proton beams collide, at the moment they collide 20 million times per second, in the future 40 million times a second. So these detectors have to take 40 million pictures a second. Of course, not all of them are then stored because it would be impossible, but they have to be very fast. So another feature of this detector is to be extremely fast. So you see already the challenge. It was also a challenge from the engineering point of view. For instance, this picture shows the Atlas cavern, so the cavern housing the Atlas detector, 100 meters underground, in June 2003, just after the end of the excavation work, where the cavern was handed over from the civil engineering team to us, to the experiment, and we started the installation. Okay? So it looked pretty empty, and then we started to lower the support structure of the experiment, and then various pieces. In particular, you can notice here these eight big objects. These are eight superconducting magnets. Each one of them is 100 tons, 25 meter long, and again is used to bend and measure the energy of the particles produced in the in-wind collision. And so this picture shows the detector at a very good stage of the installation, when it was almost in large part installed. And again, this is a person. So you can see the size. But you can also see the beauty. It's really beautiful from an aesthetical point of view. Also remarkable is the size and the geographical spread of the scientists involved in the LHC experiment. So this is a map, a warm up of Atlas. Atlas is an experiment which is run by 3,000 scientists, physicists, engineers, and many technicians also, from all over the world, from 38 countries, more than 170 institutions. So you see in yellow from South Africa to Australia to China, Japan, Russia, the US, etc. And in particular, the US is contributing to ATLAS, to this experiment, with 41 universities and laboratories, more than 600 scientists, and note, 250 of them are students, so many students. And in particular, the SLAC team consists of almost 50 scientists and have made very strong contribution to the detector construction, to the detector operation, now to the upgrade of the detector for the next phase, software and computing and physics. And so they made a very, very strong, important contribution. I would like to show this plot, which gives you the distribution, the age distribution of the Atlas population for boys in blue and girls in red. And you see that out of the 3,000 scientists, actually most of them, 1,000 are PhD students. So one-third of the experiment is run by, one-third of the collaboration is very young. You see that most people are here. I am here in this bin. Don't laugh, it's not nice. Anyway, the other thing that I would like to note, is, in addition to the very young age of most of the physicists working in Atlas, is that you see the fraction of women is typically 25% on average, but it grows in the younger part of the spectrum. So it means that among the younger generation, there are more and more women participating in these experiments, which is, of course, very nice. Okay, I think I will skip computing, and then I will leave it to question, of course. And before going to the main topic, a few additional numbers to impress you, in case you're not already impressed. So protons are running in the LHC ring close to the speed close to that of light, and so they make something like 11,000 turns of the full 27-kilometer ring per second. When the beam get into collision, they are very much squeezed, and their transverse size is, as a typically a few 10 to 20 microns, so it's four times smaller than that of a typical human hair. I already mentioned that the LHC is the coldest place of the universe. These beams, of course, have a lot of energy and a lot of protons, so the energy stored in the beams is extremely large, 350 megajoule. If you want to know what it means, I read that it corresponds to the energy of a British aircraft carrier traveling at 12 knots. Now, why it has to be British, I don't know, but it's so I just report that it's a British carrier. The CMS experiment, the other experiment, contains more iron than the Eiffel Tower in Paris, and it weighs more than the Eiffel Tower. In Atlas, we use 3,000 kilometer cables to bring the signal from the detector in the underground cavern to the control rooms. Every year, each LHC experiment produces of the order of 10 petabytes of data. Everyone knows what a petabyte is, but if you wanted to write it on DVDs, you will need a pile of 20 million of them or a pile of 20 kilometer stack. So it's quite impressive. So clearly the question is why. Okay, so let's come to the motivation. Now, the elementary particles and their interactions are extremely well known today, thanks to almost 40 years of experimental work, discoveries, measurement made at laboratories from all over the world, at CERN, SLAC, Fermilab, and other laboratories. So this is on the experimental side. On the theoretical side, we have a theory called the standard model, which has been extremely predictive. All the particles predicted by the standard model have been discovered, the last one a few months ago. And all the prediction of the standard model, which described the particles, elementary particles and their interaction, have been verified with very high precision by the experiment, so the theory is extremely successful. The problem, however, is that although the standard model is a correct theory, it's not a complete theory. It's not complete because it's not able to answer several questions and observations. So the first one, the question that we had actually for almost 50 years is, what is the origin of the particle masses, of the masses of the elementary particles? So this is the question related to the Higgs boson, on which I will concentrate in the next slide, and we essentially ticked off this question, or we are very close to say, understood, this is done. But there are many other questions that the standard model is not able to answer. For instance, what is the nature of the universe dark matter? We know that about 20-25% of the energy matter content of the universe is made of a form of matter which is not known, is not ordinary matter, is not made of quarks, electrons as we are made. There is no particle predicted by the standard model. None of the particles we have observed is a good candidate to explain the dark matter. So it must be a particle, there must be some physics beyond the standard model which contains these other particles or field or whatever. What is the origin of the asymmetry in the universe between matter and antimatter, thanks to the asymmetry we are here, otherwise we would not be here, antimatter would have annihilated. But we don't understand why at some point there's been something which happened in the early universe which has produced some imbalance between matter and antimatter. This is not cannot be explained fully by the standard model. And also address other questions like, are there additional forces in addition to the four that we know, etc. So the LHC has been built to address this another fundamental question, perhaps give answer to some of them, and actually managed to answer at least the first one, but to try at least to make some step forward. And the adventure started on the 30 March 2010, when first proton beams were accelerated and brought to collision at the New Energy Frontier at 3 TeV per beam at that time. Then we went up to 4 TeV per beam. And so we started on 30th of March 2010, marks the start, the beginning of the exploration of the New Energy Frontier. So since then, several things happened. We have been taking data over the last 3 years. The three components The accelerator, the experiments, and the computing have been performed extremely well, beyond the most optimistic expectation, usually giving also, taking also into account that these are very complex and unprecedented instruments, so usually it takes a lot of time to get an accelerator experiment to work in a reliable way, but it went extremely fast. We were the first to be surprised. The experiment have recorded a huge amount of data, and we have analyzed them, or we are in the process of analyzing them. We have, in some sense, rediscovered the standard model. That is, we have observed all the particles that were already discovered in the past, the top quark, the W and the Z boson, that, of course, nothing new, but we have rediscovered them at the LHC, and we have measured them in a new energy regime. And also, we have explored looked for many scenario of new physics beyond the standard model. These are theoretical ideas that try to answer the question that I listed before, to which the standard model is not able to answer. And many of these scenarios have been actually discarded because we were not able to confirm their predictions. But most importantly, in July 2012, the two biggest experiments, ATLAS and CMS, reported the observation of a new particle which looked very much like the Higgs boson, and since then it looks even more much like the Higgs boson. So it's really we call it Higgs boson. We've dropped the like, although we like it. It's not my joke. It's the CERN director joke, preferred joke. So I don't want to take credit for this joke. So the mass of this particle is typically 130 proton masses. Okay, so the question now is why there is so much excitement around this particle? This particle is associated with this question of what is the origin of the masses of the elementary particles. So why the heaviest elementary particle? Elementary means cannot be broken into pieces. The heaviest elementary particle observed so far, the top quark, which was discovered at the Tevatron at Fermilab in 1995, has a mass comparable to that of a gold atom. And the electron has a mass which is 350,000 times smaller. Why the photon is massless? It's pure energy. It travels at the speed of light. You know, the photon is the quantum of light. So it's photons are all around here in this room. And the W and the Z boson, which transfer the weak force, whereas the photon transfer on a microscopic level the electromagnetic force. Why the W and Z boson are massive? The masses corresponding to about 100 proton masses. The origin of the masses was not clear. In the early 60s, a group of physicists, among which Peter Higgs, a Scottish physicist, but few others, Braut, Angler, Guralnik, Hagen, and Keeble, develop a mechanism to allow elementary particles to get masses, which is called Higgs mechanism, or Braut-Angler Higgs mechanism. So I will try to explain to you in a very simple way, in a pictorial way, how this mechanism works, how I understood it works. So theorist, experimentalist, expert in the room, you are asked to fall asleep and not listen to what I'm going to say. So it worked in the same way. Imagine the early universe and the Big Bang. At the beginning, all particles are massless. They are pure energy. They travel at the speed of light. They go around. They run in a universe, happily, etc. Okay? Imagine that in the universe is permeated by a kind of medium in physics, we can call it a field. It's a medium, and this medium at the beginning is transparent, is there, but the particles do not see it. And the temperature then goes down. We said there was a big bang, and then the universe expanded and cooled down. Okay, so the temperature goes down. At some point, where the temperature reaches a given value, there is a transition phase, and the transparent medium becomes a more solid medium. Transition phase is a complicated term to indicate something very simple. When water becomes ice, this is the transition phase. The temperature goes down and water becomes ice. Similarly, you are in the universe, you have this medium which is transparent, temperature goes down and this transparent medium becomes something more solid. This something more solid, imagine, is a kind of jam, marmalade, molasses, something disgusting like that, okay? And this transition phase happened 10 to the minus 11 seconds after the Big Bang. Now we know that happened at that time. It's 100 of a billion of a second after the Big Bang, so it was quite early, okay? So now the particles, which were before going around happily seeing no medium because the medium was transparent, now see something which is more consistent, okay? And imagine now the particles are little balls. And if the ball is very, the surface of the ball is very smooth, then the particles go through the jam and doesn't feel anything. But if the surface is more rough, then of course it starts to attract and stick marmalade and jam and molasses and becomes fatter and is slowing down. Okay, so the photon went through the molasses without interacting, was at a smooth surface, and so remained massless, just energy. Other particles got more massive, and because they had a rough surface, and acquired the mass and slowed down. So this is pictorially the mechanism of the Higgs mechanism. In physics, what we say is that the Higgs field, the particles interacting with the Higgs field, acquire a mass, and the mass is proportional to the interactions with the strength of the interaction with the Higgs field. Okay, this is very nice. However, the problem is that as a consequence of this mechanism, the theory predicted the existence of an additional new particle called the Higgs boson, and this particle has been looked for 40 years at accelerator and experiments from all over the world, and was not found. So this mechanism was nice, but there was no proof that it was true. Until finally it was announced, a discovery was announced at CERN in July. So since July, we know that this mechanism is correct. Now, I'm sure that now we are going to ask a question, a legitimate question. Which one? Who cares? Who cares about this thing, the particle masses, the Higgs mechanism, the molasses, the 10 to the minus 11 second, all these things? Well, we should care because a world without this Higgs mechanism or something similar would be a very strange one. If the elementary particles did not have exactly the mass they have, we would not be here. Or perhaps we would be here, but a completely different shape. The universe would not be what it is because the proton may decay. If a proton decays, there are no atoms, there is no chemistry, there are no elements, there is nothing. So we are what we are, and our universe is what it is, because the elementary particles have exactly the masses they have. But unfortunately, until the 4th of July last year, we didn't know how this works. And now we know that this works in this way. Okay, so it was clearly important. So what did we see? What did we observe? Well, the Higgs boson, when it is produced, decays immediately, disintegrates immediately in known particles. For instance, it can decay into two photons. Again, photons are familiar to everyone. So, for instance, this is an event recorded by the CMS experiment. The two beams come from here, the two yellow arrows. They collide here. You see many particles produced, and among which two photons. So you look at the spectrum of the two photons, which is a smooth spectrum, due to various processes that we know already, not particularly interesting. And if there is something new, a new particle, you will see a peak, you will see a kind of spike. And this is what the CMS experiment has seen. So this is the Higgs boson. It can also decay, for instance, into four electrons. Electrons are also very well-known particles in our day-by-day life. So this is an event recorded by ATLAS. The two beams have interacted here. You see many particles going out, and these red and blue lines indicate the signal deposited by the four electrons in the detector. It was not easy to find it because one of these four electron events coming from the Higgs is produced every 10,000 billion proton-proton collisions. So we had really to dig into this huge amount of collision. So it was a huge amount of very detailed and hard experimental work to extract such a tiny signal and difficult signal to observe from the background of other processes that are not particularly interesting, or they are interesting, but they are not new in any case. Okay, so let me go through three frequently asked questions. So I can anticipate perhaps your curiosity. First question. Is this new particle the standard model Higgs boson? Today we know that it is a Higgs-like particle, so has the features of a Higgs-like particle. However, we don't know if it yet completely, fully, if it is the Higgs particle predicted by Peter Higgs and collaborators, or a Higgs particle in a more belonging to a more complex and wide and broad theory. Of course, you will prefer this second solution because it means that there is physics beyond the standard model, and there is a new theory and perhaps new spectrum of other particles that we may be able to discover. We are measuring our new friend in all details to try to understand its properties as much as we can, but we cannot say if it is standard or exotic. Second, is the goal, the task of the LHC over? And the answer is no, of course. This is just the beginning for various reasons. First of all, we are going to, as I mentioned, we are going to measure this particle in all details. Second, this particle itself raises several questions that I cannot go into details. Why is it so light, etc. And as usual in research, you answer a question and n others, of course, open and are raised. So it's very nice that of course we make progress, but at every step there is more and more to know and to understand. And third point, the LHC was built to address many more questions than just the origin of the particle masses. You remember the list of questions I mentioned before. This was just the first one, and there are many others. So we will continue, and we'll try to not only to perfection our understanding of the Higgs boson, but also to address the other question, dark matter, matter antimatter asymmetry, and so on and so forth. And the last question. Will the Higgs boson change our day-by-day life? And my reply to this question is, yes, it did already. Perhaps you didn't realize that, but it did already. And the reason is the following, that in order to be able to discover the Higgs boson, we had to develop over the last 20 years so much technology in so many fields that this technology now is being used almost in a normal, regular way in our day-by-day life. This is a general feature of particle physics, that the requirements are so stringent and the performance is so extreme that it requires really development, very, very often development of new concept, new technology that then later on are forced transferred to society. This was true at CERN, this is true at SLAC, where you have examples, of course, of applications of accelerator techniques, for instance, to the understanding of material science, medical application, etc. I mentioned the web at the beginning, which was originally something developed for a specific purpose in our laboratories, and then, of course, it has been used and it has been transferred to society to the advantage of everyone's life. I give you just one example. Today in the world there are 30,000 accelerators. More than half of them, 17,000, are used for medical applications. For instance, to treat cancer by bombarding a tumor in a very localized way by using, for instance, protons or ions that are very much localized, so they don't destroy the rest of the surrounding tissue. Okay, and so, but these accelerators are based on the technologies developed in laboratories like SLAC, like CERN, Fermilab, and many others. Today, if you go to see a doctor, I hope you don't have to go too often, but one of the typical scanners that you do is called PET, positron emission tomography, and this is a scanner, type of scanner, which is based on the technology developed in particle physics laboratories to build detectors, particle detectors. So I'm close to my conclusion. Is it okay? Do you want to go on for another hour? No, it's okay. Ah. No, it was too fast. I can start again. Okay. So. So I'm going to my conclusion. So particle physics at high energy accelerator, of which Bob Hofstadter was one of the pioneers, looks for answer to fundamental question about elementary particles, the very small, and therefore also about the very big, so the universe. To achieve this goal, we have to advance the frontiers of technology, of course, also to the benefit of society. Our experiments, I think, are a very nice place to train the young generation. You see, there are many, many young people. There are many data, so there is a lot of possibility of doing many studies, PhD theses, etc. But also because these projects are worldwide, these are big projects, so require the collaboration of not only many nations, but many regions in the world, and so are fantastic places to bring people together and to make them work peacefully for scientific purposes. With the advent of the LHC, a new era of discovery has started, with exploration of a new and unprecedented energy scale and the observation of the Higgs boson, which is clearly a big step forward in fundamental knowledge. I have stressed the social benefits and the application and spin-off coming from this kind of research. But I would like to conclude by saying something a bit different, saying that fundamental science, fundamental research, just itself, by itself in some sense, for various reasons. First of all, because fundamental research is the, in some sense, the fuel which feeds applications. Without fundamental knowledge and progress in fundamental knowledge, at some point application becomes sterile. You don't have new ideas which allow you to make progress. Of course, as a consequence, with dramatic impacts also on progress, economy, developments, etc. Second point, I show you that in some sense the Higgs boson has already changed our life, because to find it we had to develop many new technologies that we are now using in our day-by-day life. But you may also ask the question, but this particular particle, the Higgs boson itself, will it change our life? And the answer to this question, of course, is more difficult. Of course, not today, perhaps not tomorrow. You didn't notice any change in your life on the 5th of July, the day after the announcement of the discovery, of course. But I'm sure that perhaps in 10 years from now, perhaps 20, perhaps 100, there will be some progress from that. Because every time you make a step forward in fundamental knowledge, sooner or later, it will transform itself into progress. When at the end of the 19th century, British scientist, Sir J.J. Thomson, observed for the first time in a rudimental cathode ray tubes, which is just a precursor of the television, a little beam of electrons, thereby observing for the first time the electron, I don't think that his life or the life of his neighbor changed that day, nor the day after. But today we could not live without electricity. So every time you make a step forward in fundamental knowledge, then progress will come. But also, I would like to stress another important point that I was discussing with Professor Dimopoulos just before the beginning of this lecture. Knowledge, pretty much like art, are among the highest expression of the human beings are clever beings. There are two features which distinguish us from animals. An Italian poet of the 13th century, Dante Alighieri, wrote, "Fatti non foste a vivere come bruti, ma per seguir virtute e conoscenza." You were not born, you were not created to live as brutes, as animals, but to pursue virtue and knowledge. So if we kill fundamental knowledge, if we kill art, we, in some sense, alter the nature of mankind, of the human being. So for this reason, I think art and knowledge deserve to be supported and pursued and encouraged. Okay, thank you.
Before I get into questions, I should have mentioned tomorrow Fabiola at 4:15 will be giving the physics colloquium. So for those of you who are more technically oriented, you're welcome to come to her colloquium. Now I take questions.
I don't know if you remember last July when you made the announcement.
I am.
There was a press conference right afterwards, and there was a fairly sizable reporter who asked the director, "Is my mass due to the Higgs?" The director said no, and he was very disappointed. Can you comment on that?
The director was right. Your mass is not our mass, is not due to the Higgs. There is a nice cartoon in the US, perhaps you have seen it, which a very fat guy saying, looking at the screen and following the announcement of the discovery of the Higgs boson, say, now I understand why I'm so fat. It's not my fault, it's that I made too many Higgs bosons. Yeah, because most of the mass of the universe does not come from the mass of the elementary particles, but it comes from the bonding energy that stick this particle, keeps this particle together in the nuclei, in the atoms, etc. So unfortunately, the mass of the universe does not come from the masses of the elementary particles. This is a tiny fraction of the mass of the universe. But it's so important, this mass is so important for other reasons. The size of the atoms depends on the mass of the electron. If the electron had another mass, then the atoms will have completely different sizes, perhaps will not stick together. So it's crucial, but not that much in terms of mass, actually.
Why do some people refer to this as the God particle?
So the reason is that, well, actually, the reason is simply due to the fact that many years ago, I don't know if it was 20 years ago or so, a famous physicist, Leon Lederman, Nobel Prize, wrote a book, actually, not only on the Higgs boson, but the Higgs boson was an important part of the book. And he wanted the title he had chosen was the Dawn Particle, something like that. And the editor found that such a title would never sell, and so he decided to change it into the God Particle, and he was right, because actually he had a lot of success with the God Particle. But so it has nothing to do with religion, it's just a commercial problem. Yes.
What are the current theories for the origin of dark matter? Is there any relationship to the Higgs field or the Higgs boson?
My first answer about the Higgs boson in relation to the Higgs boson is no, but I will give the microphone to Professor Dimopoulos, who is the worldwide expert of dark matter.
There is perhaps the most popular theory is the so-called supersymmetric theory. And the lightest supersymmetric particle is the best, we feel, candidate for the dark matter of the universe. And it's the best in the sense that if you estimate the amount of matter contained in this lightest supersymmetric particle, it comes roughly within the right ballpark to be the dark matter, the measured amount of dark matter in the universe. That's one candidate. The other candidate is another particle called the axion, which is a whole other colloquium. So I'll leave it there. But you may hear something more about searches for the supersymmetric dark particles in tomorrow's colloquium.
Right. So if dark matter is made of neutralinos, the particle that Professor Dimopoulos was mentioned, there are hopes, serious hopes, to serve it at the LHC. If it's made of axion, no hope. So let's.
So when you increase the energy from 8 to 14 GeV, what are you hoping to discover or find? Would you be looking for supersymmetric particles?
Yeah, so we will continue to do what we have been doing until now. So looking for anything and everything. So we have been looking for supersymmetric particles, we have been looking for extra dimension, we have been looking for many scenarios of physics beyond the standard model. So now, the perspective now change a bit. First of all, now we have a new object, which is there, which has been discovered. So we will continue to measure it with the present data, but then, of course, we can measure it even better with higher energy, because the production, I mean, the rate at which it's produced goes up, and we will also have more data. So we will measure this object in all details. We will continue to explore to look for physics beyond the standard model, because, as I mentioned before, there are many questions to which today we are not able to answer. So clearly there must be some theory beyond the standard model. The problem is, what is the energy scale where this theory manifests itself? Would 14 TeV will be enough to have some at least hints of this theory, or does this theory sit at an energy scale which is too high to achieve with any accelerator on Earth? Okay? But of course, we will continue. There are many candidates for beyond the standard model, supersymmetry, extra dimensions, many, many others. We will continue to study those, but also I think it's very important in research to be a bit, I'll say, unbiased and have our mind clean. We, of course, we have some ideas of nice way of which a new theory could be, but nature may have chosen a completely different path. So we have to be able to be, you know, to detect and to be able to be ready to get a surprise. And for an experimental physicist and also for a theorist, I guess a totally new thing will be the best thing for all of us, I think.
How do the sensors in the ATLAS detector work to detect particles? Which principle do they use?
We use a principle like typically ionization. So a charged particle passes through a material and produces ions, dissociate the atoms into ions and electrons, and these are collected by, you apply an electric field and these are collected, and then you get an electric signal. You can have light. So this is one of the principles, but there are many others, okay? So a particle traversing a gas, a solid state element, a liquid argon. The medium can change, but typically this is one of the main way you can detect the particle. So it's simple, but of course you have to do it with very, very little sensor. The smallest elements in the ATLAS detector, the pixel detector, has the pixel sensor have a size of 40 microns. So, and then you go to the external spectrometry in the most external part of the detector, where chambers extend over several meters. So you see, it's a very complex, complex instrument.
I understand that some of the simplest supersymmetry models have already been ruled out by, you know, data from LHC and other facilities. What can you say about, you know, the prospects for supersymmetry at this point?
He's one of the fathers of supersymmetry.
Well, I think the best answer I can provide is to come to the colloquium tomorrow, because Fabiola will show exactly quantitatively what has been looked for, what has been excluded, and where the future may lie when the energy of the LHC doubles.
You for the commercial for the
So, Fabiola, there's 3,000 people on the experiment. Do you think the Higgs deserves a Nobel Prize? And how do you share that with the 1,000 young scientists?
Deserve? Yes, of course. Now, we will get it? Probably no. Well, I don't know. Of course, you know, it's, first of all, if the Nobel Prize is something that is given to individuals, maximum three, no way. Because these experiments have been, there are two big experiments, each one made of 3,000 physicists, ATLAS and CMS, and there is an accelerator which has been built and run by an accelerator community that you know very well. So just picking up three people out of this big community will be unfair, because there have been a generation of scientists giving their life for this project. If, of course, the Nobel Prize can be given to experiments, so ATLAS get one, CMS get another one, and the accelerator get a third one, we will be happy. But I don't know if it's possible. And in any case, the decision is not in my hands. But of course, I think that the young people in ATLAS and CMS will deserve it, yes. They've been working so hard and with so much passion.
You mentioned a very large number, 10 to the 23, if I remember. Collisions to get to what you think a Higgs-like particle. Is there now, once you know it's there, is there a significant improvement in the number of collisions you need to reproduce?
So, it's a very good question. So, let's say, in some sense, knowing that the particle is there, we can make our analysis more effective, and so we can make a better use of our data. That is, being able to extract more of this. At the level of production, this will not change, because what you produce, but then after you produce a Higgs boson, of course, you have to develop an analysis to extract it from the huge amount of data that you have. And becoming more clever, knowing that it's there, and perfectioning our analysis, we can become more efficient and extract more from the background of collisions. From the point of view of the way, so in this sense, yes. On the other hand, for what concerns the selection of the events, as I mentioned before, of all the collision, proton-proton collision, we take pictures at every collision, but we not store all the pictures, because it will be impossible to. So we have to select online with a system which is called Trigger, by the way, on which the Slack group has been working a lot. We have to say online immediately in a time scale of, in some sense, a fraction of a few microseconds, if an event we keep it or we reject it. Okay, and if you reject it, it's rejected forever, it's lost. Okay, so better you. Now, we know now that Higgs boson is there, so we can develop our online selection in such a way that we enhance its contribution. But on the other hand, it's also true that we would like to be extremely open. Again, we don't want to focus now too much on the Higgs boson, because we can miss something else. So we have to find a good compromise between targeting this new particle and at the same time being open enough to get any new things that may be there.
Two more questions. We can go to that side.
How do you validate the computing and detector portions of the experiment?
Sorry, how?
How do you validate the computing and detector portions of the experiment separate from the accelerator?
We had 17 years of test beams, means that we have put pieces of our detectors on beams and studied their behavior in all details. We have tested every single connector or piece of detector under radiation to make sure that it stands the radiation of the LHC. So it's an enormous amount of work over these 20 years have been used also in this reason. For the computing, the computing has been validated with data challenges before starting. So once the computing infrastructure was in place, and this computing is based now on a grid of computers located all over the world, if I manage to go back to the grid. So we essentially have been doing data challenges, which we have produced a huge amount of data, simulated data, and we have sent it all over the world and tried to reproduce the way it will work when we would have real data. This was pre-data taking. And then when we started to take data, things work very well right from the beginning, which was good, of course, which doesn't mean that everything was perfect. We have been perfectioning our model. But it was, these 20 years have been a huge amount of work in terms of testing. And I think the success of the experiments and of the computing and accelerator is that over these 20 years, we have put so much attention to the details, to the quality control of things. And so this is the computing system of the of the LHC is made of, is a distributed system, because it's impossible to store all this amount of data and to process all this data in the main lab, which is CERN. So it's based on a grid of computing centers from all over the world. You see there are 150 computing centers in 35 countries. In the US, there are two main centers, one at Brookhaven and one at Fermilab, and then 14 smaller but very active centers, which one is at Slack. And so data are dispatched to this computer center from all over the world, and people can access them everywhere. And I remember when we started to take data at the LHC, it was quite impressive to see that we were dispatching the data immediately. Now we don't do so. We first calibrate them at CERN. But within 7 hours of data taking, the data were already distributed all over the world. So people sitting in Japan, in Taiwan, in the US, were able to see the data immediately. And this is very important, of course, because when you build an experiment like that, a detector like that, which requires a lot of work from people from all over the world, you can imagine the frustration of people if the day we start to take data after 20 years of efforts, the data are stuck at CERN, and only people at CERN can work on them, and the others have to wait. And But fortunately, this did not happen. And so really, the analysis is being made worldwide by students from all over the world.
Maybe Heisenberg is defunct. I don't know if it's relevant, but can you be absolutely sure that this is not an anomaly of the measurement system? So I guess it's sort of a follow-up question. And are there skeptics who doubt the veracity of this discovery?
So, of course, you have to be very cautious when you observe something. You cannot just see something which is just a hint or a fluctuation and go out and say that you have a discovery. So there are standards in our field by which you cannot. Usually, when you have to announce a claim in discovery, you have to reach a certain probability that what you observe is not due to the fluctuation of background, for instance. And this probability has to be larger than one part over 3 million or something like that. Today, with more data, so this is what we have announced in July. This probability of that the background fluctuates of 3 × 10⁻⁶ was shared by what was in both experiments individually, so two independent experiments with two different detectors, with two different technology, with two different communities, have observed the same thing. So this is already clearly a very good idea. Today, with more data, the probability that what we observe is due to the fluctuation of the background is 10⁻¹⁴, 15, or something like that. We are at the level of 10 sigma, so it's clearly not. What was the second question? Sorry.
I just wondered, are there any skeptics despite those probabilities?
Skeptics, not that I know about the fact that we observe the new particles. Now, about the interpretation, if it is the Higgs, the standard model Higgs, or not, or if it is exotics, or this, of course, is still a debate. And of course, we don't know for the moment. But about the observation, I think this is now the signal continues to increase. And so it's absolutely no doubt. It's a new object.
Yeah, supposing it turns out that even when the machine is pushed up to 14, is that the number?
14 and 15.
Nothing clear is discovered, but there are some tantalizing hints. Can it be pushed past 14?
15.2 is the maximum.
That's it. Why is that? Why
because the magnets cannot. Well, because you can. It's the question of the magnets of the magnetic field that you can reach. The field 8.3 tesla in principle allows you to reach something like for 15.2 TeV. There is another problem. The reason why we perhaps will not go to the 14 TeV immediately, but 13 TeV is that. The magnets undergo some, these magnets are superconducting magnets. But a magnet can, if there is a little bit of local heating here and there, can lose superconductivity, a phenomenon that we call quench. So usually this problem, this quench are due to, for instance, some little movements of the cable, something like that. And usually they stabilize after some training curves. The problem is that it has been observed that up to 13 TV or so, the training curves that you have to do, training tests that you have to do, are at the level of up to a few hundred. But then to go to 14 TV, you have to do several thousand training quench studies, which of course is not good also for the magnet themselves. So this is another problem. You're welcome.
The LHC has been extremely productive. To what extent would an electron-positron high-energy linear collider add to what you can do with LHC?
It's a complementary machine. It's a complementary machine because it's a machine that allows you to measure, for instance, the properties of the Higgs boson with extremely, extremely high precision. So this will be very, very useful. The problem is that today you can think of two things. You can think, if I have enough money, I build a plus and minus collider, which allows me, which of an energy of typically 240 GeV or so, 250 GeV, which allows me to measure the properties of the Higgs boson very with high precision. The Higgs boson exists, is there. We don't know if it is standard or exotic. If you want to measure it in all details, we build this machine. This will be very nice in a world, well, of course, where there is an infinite amount of money. And the reason is that suppose that in 2 years from now, or a few years from now, we discover new physics at the LHC, and this physics is heavy. Then you would like to use the linear collider to also study this new physics, which is heavier. And for this, you need a higher energy linear collider. So a linear collider can be very helpful. The problem is that we have to understand today which energy. Do we concentrate on the Higgs? Do we want something with higher energy? Do we want something we can be upgraded, starting with the Higgs, Higgs factory, as it's called, and then go up in energy, which is probably a good solution. So at the moment, there is a lot of this, a big debate in the community to see what is the next machine. It may well be, for instance, that at the LHC, we hopefully discover new physics. This new physics has a very rich spectrum of particles. We have clear evidence that what we see at the LHC is the lower part of the spectrum, and the higher part is heavier. So in that case, you may want to build a hadron collider, because you have to go higher. So yes, a linear collider is very useful, but one has to decide when is the right moment. And for me, the right moment to decide is when we have some indications from the high energy LHC at 14 TeV in a couple of years from now.
Let's save the rest of the questions for private discussion. Let's thank Fabiola.